Michael, can you start off on your side, please?
Sure. Mike Rubidy, Ohio Department of Health, your radiation protection.
Maria Galanti, Ohio EPA.
Carlton Kane, board member.
Stan Kraft, board member.
Carl Hartley, board member.
Dan Metzger, board member.
Charlie Payne, board member.
Martha Cosby, board member.
Christie Renner, board member.
Jeff Manson, board member.
Al Gon Cisco, board member.
Full Anderson, Chairman. Joel Radford, DDFO.
Greg Simonson, federal coordinator.
Eric Roberts, EHI. Hey, welcome. Happy New Year, everyone. It's good to see you. I know that it was cold and freezing outside, and yet you chose to be here, and we're very thankful that this is important. We can spend the evening with you tonight. A short meeting to plan, but we'll make it beneficial and make sure everyone leaves with good stuff. So, the first thing on the agenda is, of course, approving the agenda. It's under tab one in your binders. Has everyone had a chance to review the agenda? Are there any changes or corrections to the agenda?
I moved to second.
Got a motion second. All in favor of proceeding with the agenda as presented? Say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Good deal. Under tab two, you will see a copy of the November minutes. Has anyone had a chance to review the minutes? Are there any changes or corrections that need to be made to the minutes? All right, got a motion to accept the minutes.
A second.
Got a second. All those in favor of accepting the minutes as presented, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Good deal. Under tab three, you'll see a copy of your presentation, and for our members of the public, it'll be on the board. And before we slip over to the EDFO presentation, let me remind members of the public that if you would like to speak tonight, we will have a public comment portion of our meeting. A little farther down the agenda. And we just ask that you sign up, and we'll make sure that we set aside a little bit of time for you to take part in the public comments portion of the meeting. So with that, we're going to slide over to Joel and let you do the EDFO comments.
Okay. Thank you, Eric. And again, welcome everybody. Hope everybody's enjoying the holidays and hope everybody's staying warm. Challenge, I guess. Talk a little bit about what's going on at the plant, a little bit about our regulatory process that we're going through, the status on that, some of our community outreach activities that have transpired, and a little bit of a preview of upcoming events. So, excuse me. So this just gives a little back over the past several years. We talked about the cut and cap activities, part of our sampling and characterization effort in 326. Primarily, processed gas equipment is the focus there. And of course, once we do our analysis or do our surveys of material, then it's shipped off site to the Nevada test site. So you can see we kind of track progress, FY12, FY13, FY14. If you can't see that, it's a little bit fuzzy right there. But of course, you can see 12, we just kind of kicked into it. 13 and 14 was kind of coming into a steady state. The cell equivalent is primarily broken down. If you recall some of the previous discussions, cell is really comprised of a compressor, a converter, and a cooler. Right, so three primary components. And if you look at that, you kind of get a feel for, once we get we have to establish an assay technique, a survey technique, then we have to establish, the transportation disposal protocol. And so we really went after it kind of systematically, component by component. And so then if you kind of look at that, you can see, converters were the big push early on. Then we finally got that under our belt. We moved over to compressors. You can see compressor numbers then picking up. And in this last year, we really focused on cooler. So right now, I would say that we're kind of hitting on all cylinders right there. So we've got pretty much down pat for both wall compressors, converters, and coolers, and the folks did a really good job safely moving out on the process gas equipment. Number-wise, so it's hard to tell the numbers right there, but just got a little note here in front of me. So in FY12, there were about a little bit over 1,000 compressors, compressors, a little more than 813 converters. Of course, there's 12, in FY12, there were 161, 905, and 834 in 14. And the coolers are a lot smaller component. You kind of see a picture of it, you kind of imagine a scale there based on the floor footprint right there. Really, this year was our big year. We had over 1,000 shipped in 2014. The other thing we're doing, because obviously the facility shut down, so we're looking at hazardous waste in there, but also we're concerned about fire loading, as you might imagine. It's a big building, and one of the primary things that add to the fire loading in the facility, as you might imagine, is oil. And so we've been moving about 6,000 gallons of oil out of 326. This stuff goes to a place called Clean Harbors, where they incinerate it. So we pull it, characterize it, containerize it, ship it, and then it gets disposed out of it. So good job by those folks there. The other thing that I'll mention, and again, this is kind of I'll say repurposing old facilities or existing facilities, the X705 decontamination building. So if you can remember back in the production era, uranium was more valuable than gold, and so you wanted to recover every bit that you could. You didn't want to waste anything. And so as things would come out of the production product, the process gas enrichment process, parts, equipment, even in some cases waste, if it had any U-235 content associated with it, and they take it over to 705 and try to recover it. And so where that's helping us now, as you might imagine, is we're trying to dispose of the material. We kind of use the same processes that the facility was designed for to downwind some of the higher assay stuff to make it suitable for disposal. So the folks over there, there's a grand library process that they use, and also they do physical tear down and mechanical, what we call mechanical mining of equipment. And so we have a converter over 326 that's what we call Bubba, PEH, which is has some mass that we have to institute some safe handling controls on. We'll move that over to 705, let the folks over to 705, pull that high assay material out and dispose of that separately, and so we can ship that converter off to the bottom. That's that for disposal. So, repurposing existing facility to match our current mission site. And the folks do a good job. It's an old building, but folks do a good job trying to keep up. I think a lot of money's been put into the place to bring it up and make it. Do its job. Shipping wise, just to look back over the past couple of years, so you see billions up there, that is weight. So those are in pounds. So that's waste going out the door. So in FY12, you don't have the calibrated eyeball there. That is, I'm sure you can tell that is actually 13,178,585.17 pounds.
I was on 5 pounds.
Got to check. Get your calibrated. Yeah. So of that, almost 2,000 pounds recycled in 12. In 2013, almost 18 million pounds shipped off site. Of that, over 6 million pounds recycled. In 14, just about 15 million pounds shipped off site. Of that, almost 5 million pounds recycled. And of course, we're just into 15, and we've moved out just over a million pounds, and we're still working on a recycled portion of that, so we're at a small, I don't want to say measly, but it's about 18,000 pounds recycled. So, looking to be, we'll just give you a snapshot of what we're doing. DF6. So, that plant has been improving, and it's, it also, again, looking back over 12, 13, and into 14, it's root just going into its startup. You can see there, it started about middle of 11. 2012 was really a startup year. 13, improving reliability. And then you can see 14 through 15, they're getting into reasonably steady state operations with some fine tuning adjustments to really get to nameplate production criteria. So that plant's been doing a good job. Folks over there have been operating in a very, very systematic and methodical fashion as well. Talk a little bit about transition from the startup. So you kind of see there, measure operability, the amount the plant's operating in a given year in terms of plant availability. And so you see that by 12, just a little better, 25%. 13, about 6 months out of the year you're running. And in FY 14, you're running for the better part of the year. So you can see step change improvements. Again, it's just a nice methodical approach. And you're getting, I think, where you want to be. This next slide, a little bit busy. Greg, can you read those yellow labels on there?
Yeah, some of your storage area.
Just want to check. Have to rely on Dan for clarification of this, but anyway, this just really goes into some of these fine tuning adjustments and plant reliability things that they're going into. Investing in the plant, for the long haul in this thing, and looking at replacing hydrogen generation technology. I think just some of these I'll call them single point failures of the facility. So if one of these units went out, it would be take the whole unit out. So we're looking at improving a little bit of I guess defense and depth and some of these critical components to make sure that that they improve reliability and improve the availability of that. I will read those to you and see those. here we're talking, this is our chart that doesn't change much, that actually chart looks the same, it's a little bit more, but it does talk about our pump and treat operations, and it gives you a sense of what we've done since we started the fiscal year. You can also see which ones are the most productive. Let's see, we've linked it to, so I didn't want it to be kind of misleading, so you think that it's 624 where the little building is, it services the 701B plant. So you kind of link these treatment facilities to the actual groundwater source that it's going after. You kind of see our most productive areas. Interestingly enough, 7-unit plume, 627, actually, we delivered via pumper truck, and we pumped the sumps in the buildings over there and treated. So anyway, just gives you a representation of how much water we treat, how productive they are in terms of TC removed, gives you a snapshot as we move into 2015.
Joel?
Yes.
If we go on the left slide there, it showed 0 pounds for TCE on 6,000 gallons. At what point does it become financially practical to keep those operations running?
623 on that one, that's a little bit unique. So that's not one that operates, I'll say routinely. So 623 is really intermittent operation. You can see groundwater source, miscellaneous site. So if you were gonna kind of, answer your question, I'd say you'd probably probably want to look more at the 624, 627, 622, is to see how productive and cost-effective it is. But I think we pitched up a slide before that shows that essentially, based on our unique hydrology and geology at the site, that the tightness of our soil, the amount of groundwater, it's really hard to pump and treat anything. So it's really about flow management more so than it is necessarily about PC removal, which again, roll back some of our previous discussions was how we were able to justify, you know, contaminating soil as part of our comprehensive strategy. So it saves the taxpayer dollars in the long haul. Getting everything right there, Marina?
Pretty much.
Regulatory process, of course, you guys, folks know that we moved into the public comment period. I'll say we have extended that based on a request. So we're really about, we're halfway through a 4-month window. I don't want to be premature to talk about, all the comments that we received because comment period's not over, but the comments have been coming in. They would be similar to what you would expect based on all the conversations we've had today. We look forward to moving into responsiveness summary to those comments, and that would be packaged part of the record decision that comes out. It should be hopefully this summer. So. We've been on public meetings. So anyway, this is just a recap of the formal public meeting that we had back in November 17th. It was well attended. I don't know. I think the weather wasn't this bad, but it was a challenge. There was a little bit of risk on that day too, that evening. But again, well attended. Had some good comments. Good representation all the way through, diverse representation, and I thought it went well. A little bit about what's been going on relative to committee commitment. Floor, as Greg, can you see the value of that check?
I think it's $30,000.
Close, it's $35,000.
I just made that up.
So anyway, what you see there is Ken Whittle and Nikki Piron present a check for about $35,000 to Nineway Ross County, November 19th. Got my notes here correct. Site campaign raised more than $130,000. So great job. Denise out there, she and the rest of the community really, really, and the site volunteers did a great job on that. It's a huge, huge contribution. Veterans Day luncheon, approximately 100 employees attended the Veterans Day luncheon. Community commitment fund, $6,000 each was given to the Pike Christmas Fund and Christmas gift for children. I don't really understand how blessed my family is until you see some people that are a lot less fortunate. And then the employees raised over $1,000 for the Christmas fund, $12,000 for Christmas gifts for children. So, I guess putting feet into giving yield to those in need. Mutual aid training. So we talked about our emergency response folks. I don't think they get as much credit all the way around as they should. Not only do we do mutual aid responses, but I also participated in training. Here you see Steve Arnold giving some information on the site. Had about 50 members and guests from the Pike County Firefighters Association. Monthly meeting dinner, that was October 28th. And anyway, there's so there's a strong relationship. And I think there's a, I'm sure if you're part of it, you know, there's a bond with firefighters and emergency response and personnel. The bottom picture is students from Marshall University. They got some instructions from our joint public information system. On there is Mark Scott. That was in preparation for, we had a quarterly drill, you may have heard. If you stay tuned to the radio announcements or read the paper, we know some drills going on, and that was a sidewalk drill that was back in November. Those students happen to be journalism majors and public relations majors. So again, they get to see and interact with some people do this kind of stuff for a living. It's value to them. And I think it's value for the folks that are also part of the JPIC team that we have decided to talk a little bit about what they do and how important their roles are and also give them some idea of some real world experience as well. Community tours. We did host Senator Brown's staff. Brought somebody in, talked about renewable energy. So you see Jeannie Wilson there was a sponsor, brought Dr. Evan Blummer in to partner with Power, GE of Columbus. And they look at renewables and went to the site, you know, showed what we had, encouraged them to come and bring their wares, and I think they were pretty impressed. Happy to host them. And a little bit more about holiday gift giving. So USW Women of Steel, first fundraiser luncheon for Christmas, they raised $538. So again, you can see that this is contagious, and a lot of people charitable mode right there. And I think USW Women are still very active in this area. So altogether, I understand that UK employees raised about $12,000 Christmas gifts for children. Turkeys to food banks, another $5,000 for breast cancer awareness. But anyway, those folks, very good job. And I'll do it on a volunteer basis. Coming up, next full board meeting is Thursday, March 5th. And I mentioned to you the comment period has been extended. It now goes to March 11th of 2015.
Are there any questions for Joe? Kevin?
Back on slide 4, you're talking about the liquids that were being taken off site for incineration. What contaminants are present in the oils?
So you get
that cause them to be unsuitable for reuse or recycling.
So this oil is primarily lube oil, and it goes through. As you might imagine, it's, you got, you know, pumps and mechanical stuff spinning at high speeds, and so this goes to lubricate that, and so on a recycled basis. And so you get contaminants that come from process gas components. So you have some uranium and a 326 boat gas and Tech 99 and low levels, but it has to be exposed to others. It's a hazardous place.
Okay. Any other questions? Right. Thank you, Joe.
Yep.
All right, federal coordinator comments?
Write this down. I don't have any. I'll give my time back.
Sweet. Any questions for Greg? All right. Liaison comments. Michael, why don't we start with you?
Oh, wow. Well, actually, it's been fairly quiet for us since the public meeting. We've seen some of the comments come back and worked some of those. Keeping up with the all the happenings in the news for the site. Other than that,
Any questions? Rick?
Pretty much the same. We're just kind of working with DOE right now on the RFI CNS work plan. That's to investigate some additional soils and groundwater at the site. And hopefully, I'm hoping that there is a comment letter coming back to DOE, hopefully next week sometime. Other than that, we've been reviewing the comments, and it's been pretty quiet.
Any questions for Maria? Oh, you two got off easy. All right, we're going to slide forward on the agenda. The presentation we have for tonight is a safety program overview by Mr. Barry Coe. We haven't had Mr. Coe before, so just Mr. Coe is a senior manager with 33 years of experience spanning multiple industries, including DOE, DOD, and EPA facilities. He's a certified industrial hygienist with a BS in civil engineering. Currently manages a team of safety professionals and industrial hygienists, fire protection engineers, and medical staff to ensure the health and safety of the Portsmouth site personnel and to maintain compliance with federal, state, and local requirements. His previous roles have included managing environmental safety and health personnel during successful cleanup of the Fernald, Ohio DOE site, bioenvironmental engineer of the U.S. Air Force, Air Force Reserves, and Air National Guard, including activation during Desert Storm, and technical expert on EPA's National Decontamination Team. All right, sir. I'm going to give you a mic. Is that all right?
Sure.
Good deal. All right. Mr. Coe.
Thank you.
It's always a danger to give me a mic because usually I break out in karaoke. And I would say something inappropriate about Asians and karaoke, but not going to happen. Also, as a safety person, you know, this set up here with me here, it's just like a death trap, but I will try to navigate as safely as I can out here. So I appreciate that. I guess I can take up the next 2 hours since we had light comments. That's what I'm prepared to do today. So, you know, our mission here is obviously to clean up the site, and we're here for the community, to clean up for the community. But the key word is that we have to do it safely. Okay, and so we are incentivized to make sure that we have a very tight program, a very methodical way. We have hazardous materials, we have radioactive materials, and we have to make sure this is all done safely. So it is a tough job to do, but our client, our customer, DOE, they ask that we have an integrated safety management system. All right, so what the heck does that mean? What that really means is that we have to integrate safety in everything that we do. Okay, easy to say, very much more difficult to implement. All right, but what this thing is really showing you is that we need to look at that scope of work, we need to look at the hazards, we need to make sure that we have everything planned out, and then after everything is all done, we need to talk about it and say, how can we make things better? Okay, so that's really what we're incentivized to do here. So here with our ESH&Q staff, that's environmental safety and health and quality assurance personnel. We have a whole staff that's out here, safety engineers, they're certified safety engineers, if that means anything to you guys out there. We have radiation protection personnel, industrial hygienists. What are industrial hygienists? That's me, actually. What is that? Anybody know? Does that mean I push a broom all day long? What's that? And really what that is, guys, that's like a chemical expert kind of people, okay? Asbestos, hydrogen fluoride, noise, lasers, all that good stuff, right? That's what they are. Horrible name, okay? I got to explain this thing through my whole working life, but that's what we are, okay? We obviously have a full contingent of fire protection engineers, and the fire department that's out there, they're here 24/7. The same with security officers, they're here 24/7. I know Joel was talking about emergency preparedness, lots of exercises and things of that nature, okay? In our projects, we've actually matrixed, our word is we matrix these safety, most of our safety professionals into the projects. So it's like they're embedded, okay, is another good word to use out there. They're there on a daily basis with these guys. they're looking at that scope of work, what are the hazards, okay? How are we going to control this stuff? What kind of personal protective equipment, we call it PPE? What do you need out there? And then let's do lots of monitoring and checking to make sure that no one's getting overexposed, all right? That's the group that's out there. So this is a challenging one that's out here, but we have a nuclear safety, facility safety tenants. By the way, if you have radiation experts, the way to, do we have any radiation people in here? Okay. So how do we drive him crazy? We don't say nuclear, we say nuclear, okay? If you say nuclear, that just gets those guys. And I say that every time as much as possible when I'm working with the guys, because they just love that, okay? But we do have these safety tenets. We are requiring people, you gotta follow procedures, all right? Procedure compliance. But many procedures, they're never perfect, all right? If they need to be fixed, we ask people they need to stop, they need to fix them, make sure that things are right, all right? We emphasize that. You also have a questioning attitude. What if I say, look, before I start shoveling this dirt out here, really, I think I need some gloves so I don't tear up my hands, okay? We ask people that they do that, but most people, okay, workers, anywhere that you go to, they all think they do a great job, all right? Even maybe the lowest performer, they think they're doing a great job because they're giving you input on how you really should do things, okay? It's really in everyone's nature to get things done, to work and then just go on. It's hard to have that willingness to stop that's out there. And, you know, you got all your guys, everyone's ready to go. They're ready to move the equipment, and you go like, but you know, I really think I need some safety gloves before I go out here and do work. That's what we promote people to do. Does it happen every day? No. Okay, but that's really what we're driving people to. Maybe I feel like instead of us moving all these pallets from here over to here manually, why can't we use a forklift? Okay, to do that. And maybe there's a reason why. But if we got lots of them, is that really the right thing to do? Is it the most efficient way to do? Okay. That's what we stress people to do. And make sure that we need to follow these things. Okay, we have, when I came to the site, you looked at each of the vehicles that are out there. I noticed, you know, the speed limit's 20 miles an hour. We got a lot of people that seem to be driving a lot faster than that out there. We also got parking lots where, you know, you got those lanes and stuff like that. They're just kind of zooming on through there. And you look at the vehicles themselves, there's a lot of dents in these things. So obviously something's not right out there. We started emphasizing personal accountability. You know, we do need to follow the speed limits that are out there. We've all done it. We were out there driving out there in the highway. You see the police officer with his radar, where you see those lights starting to break up there. We all fall in line with the speed limit, right? Because we have that sphere of influence with the police. And then as soon as we get far enough away, we continue on, right? We're trying to instill with people, you need to be accountable, okay? Do the right thing. When you're on the site, we do observe people driving out there. We have, we put up those monitors, those big signs that shows you how fast you're going. It's amazing. You put those out there and it just, you can see, you know, the people take that into account. And I really do see a big improvement on that out there, okay? That's all part of the whole safety culture part of it. It has nothing to do with your procedures. It has nothing to do with, you know, this integral process. It's more of the culture that's out there. And it's a very hard thing to work with, but that's what we're driving people to do. This very complex thing out here, that's how we plan a lot of our work. And so just briefly to go through it, we want to make sure that when we plan our work, we do it in a very methodical way, that we've integrated safety into the planning itself. So you go up here, you identify what your work scope is going to be, and then you got to think about what team are you going to need for that. So we're going to excavate the ground today, okay? This is an older facility. The drawings that you have for this facility may not really be up to speed because this place has been here for over 50 years. It's kind of like that box of chocolates. You start digging, you don't know what you're going to get today, all right? So when I pull my team together, I'm thinking I need a work planner, I need the supervisor, I need somebody probably from utilities, electrical, a safety guy. Maybe if there's a fire involved, I need the fire engineer to make sure we don't have a high water pressure system that's out of here. You pull your team together, all right? You walk the job down, and then you develop a plan. And that's what this, you prepare this work document. When you do your walk down, you identify a lot of these hazards that are out there. Maybe, okay, when we're bringing our equipment, we have this overhead line, this electrical line that's out here. How are we gonna control our equipment from hitting in contact with it when we bring it to site, okay? Identify your hazards over here. You prepare some safety documentation, and then you develop your work documents. So you look at our work documents, a lot of times they're very thick. They talk about what needs to happen. We try to incorporate our hazards and how we control those things in those documents. Procedures, a lot of our procedures are the same way. Okay. If it's a simple job, so, you know, what's that old joke about how many FBP workers does it take to change that light bulb, right? If it's in a room like this, not that many. We have our set work packages that we have to do that. But if you're working in a rad area and this is not, 10 feet off the ground, it's more like 30, or maybe there's a chemical tank that's nearby, then you're gonna have to get some more people involved to do that planning, okay? I'm not gonna go into all this one. I mean, suffice to say we have an executive safety council that's run by Dennis Carr. He and all the directors, they get together, they look at our site initiatives, they decide what kind of safety goals we need to set, what are the issues that are out here, what do we need to do to fix it. Okay. We have safety programs that are identifying what needs to go on in there. We have lots of committees that deal with these issues. ALARA has to do with your radiological exposures and how can we keep reducing our dose? How can we make it as low as reasonably achievable is what that means. And then we also have some subcommittees. And a lot of these things are actually employee-led, which is great. So, with this one in particular is the lighting conditions and walking surfaces, a very active group. Why is that? Because we got an old site. Okay, we have a lot of sidewalks that are kind of buckling and things like that. We have places where there are no street lights. We have a lot of challenges in that area, and you're gonna see that here in a second, okay? But a lot of these are very active groups. We're seeing a lot of good products from that. Communication group, they do a lot of our publications, and we talk about safety every day. Okay. All right, we can go on to the next one. This is showing our safety work groups. Every person is in a safety work group. So what is that? Well, that means that, let's say, all of us around this table, we all work together every day, okay? We would then make a safety work group out there. And we would choose a person to be our safety advocate. What that means, that's the person that runs the meeting, okay? That person is not gonna be the supervisor. That person is not gonna be the safety guy. And why is that? Because we're trying to promote the interaction, the involvement of our people in the safety program, okay? So that's us right here. That's our safety work group, okay? And in our division, there's all sorts of work groups that are out here, and then there's other divisions, and they have their safety work groups, okay? They can talk about safety issues that are out there. If we are if we do more work in the field, we're gonna get together every morning. We're gonna talk, it's our pre-job briefing, right? We're gonna talk about moving the dirt from over here to over to here. And when we do that, we're gonna use this equipment, everyone has to make sure they got their work gloves, their safety glasses, their high visibility vests, and things of that nature. If we're more administrative or something like that, we're gonna meet like every month, okay? And with that, we're gonna talk about safety issues. We're gonna talk about why we're not gonna have all these cords in the walking area that's out there. We're gonna talk about why we need to make sure the drawers are closed in our desks and things, and why all my stuff that's piled up there on the cabinets and things need to come down so it doesn't fall on my head, okay? These guys, we try to fix things at our level. I'm not gonna work until I get these gloves, okay? Here you go, Barry, here's your gloves. Some problem solved, okay? If it's something more that can't be fixed within our group, it's the street lamp that we're gonna be working by, or that we're gonna do some work. That's not something we can fix here, but we can bump it up to the next level, the employee safety team. And that employee safety team that has all the safety advocates, that one person from each of the groups, they get together, they talk about what funding they're gonna need. A lot of times they get with their directors, what needs to be fixed, and they fix it at that level. Well, if they can't fix that level, what if it's that we want everybody on site to wear sumo suits, okay, so that nobody gets hurt? That gets bumped up to the company employee safety team. Again, that's led by Dennis Carr from our site that's out here. They take a key individual from these ones, our union safety representatives, we have safety reps from the union, and we have all those subcommittees and those employee-led things. We'll talk about those issues, and that's where we try to solve the bigger issues that are out there. So we try to get everything solved at the lowest level, but then if not, then we go higher and then ultimately up to the top if we need to. Okay? So with all that said, everybody's in the safety work group. We got all these documents that are out here. We're all working together as one group, right? It's kind of like when I walk onto the site, you know, in the Wizard of Oz, where it goes from black and white to color, and everything is beautiful. There's like little animated birds that alight on my finger and they sing. It's kind of like that, right? When we go to, right? Carl, isn't that right? When we go to work, it's exactly like that. Unfortunately, it's not. Okay, we still have challenges that are out there. And this particular graph right here is showing us that DOE has told us that we need to keep our injury rate. This is basically comparing your injury rate for every 100 employees. We need to keep that rate below this 1.1 level here. During most of the fiscal year, which goes up until September, we've done a pretty good job, okay? Unfortunately, we've had an increase right here above that goal. And in addition to that, there's another DOE goal of 0.6. This is a DART. This means it's days away. It's people who have medical restrictions, people who are injured so severely, they maybe not be able to come into work. Did pretty good here, but we're trending upwards again here. Okay. We looked at our injuries that are out here. Over the last year, we had 27 of them over calendar year. Okay, we had 27 injuries. Of those, how many do you think are injuries not related to doing work? So it's not, you know, I'm not actively working, I'm just doing other stuff, walking or whatever.
18 out of 27.
Close, 20. 20 of the 27 injuries were, we had a lot of slips on the ice. You know, when we had the polar vortex, or what I used to call winter, okay? We had a lot of slips and falls on that day, okay? We've had a lot of slips and falls in other places too. People just, here's your established pathway, and this is where the sidewalk is, but I could also choose to go this way over here, which isn't really paved, or maybe has a narrow strip, and it is a lot quicker. And when I go that way, I kind of twist my ankle, and I hurt myself. Okay, that's some of the injuries that we're having trouble with, because the ones in the industry, you know, looking at ergonomics, wearing different gloves, those are a little bit easier to fix than I was walking up the stairs and all of a sudden my knee started hurting. Those are really hard to fix. And our challenge is, what is causing that? Okay. There's always lots of factors that are out here. One of them is, quite frankly, the average age of our workers is in their 50s. Okay. And believe it or not, that'd be me too out there. Okay. Balance is not always as good. When you do fall, probably have more serious injuries than a younger person that's out there. But I could choose to go the short way, or I could choose to go the safer way. Okay, that's the kind of things that we're trying to improve on, and I'll cover that here in a second. It's also, I don't know if you guys have heard, read the papers, our funding was at risk during this time period, okay? Everybody was concerned about whether they're gonna have a job or not the next day. And every time we've had a potential layoff, I've seen it every time, we've had an increase in injuries, okay? That doesn't mean that someone is really trying to get, you know, workers' comp or paid by the company for many, many months. It's that I'm thinking about, am I gonna have a job tomorrow, rather than consciously working in a place which really does have a lot of hazards. Okay, very difficult. So that's our challenge. How do we fix that? We try to broadcast our injuries. We try to talk about how to prevent people from getting injured. That's our daily safety sheet. We put that out every day, and it talks about all sorts of things. Okay. When we have a serious injury or an event, even if the person's not, there are no injuries, we will put out safety alerts, and we make it all red so that it draws people's attention that this is really an issue. People talk about it in those safety work groups that they have and try to focus on those things. We also put out walking safely, right? So we've had in this month especially, focusing on walking like a penguin. Does everybody know what that is? Right? You get a walk. You're not gonna walk like this. You're gonna walk more like this. You're gonna have your hands out of your pockets, okay? And you're gonna walk a little bit closer because you want to keep that center of gravity here, rather than as you step forward, your gravity is gonna go out more. Okay. And we're emphasizing to people. We actually had a company competition on a safety slogan, you know, try to get things people thinking about it. The one that won, you are the key to safety, right? Which path am I going to take? You are the key to helping to prevent these injuries that are out here. In addition to that, we have these things called critical pathways, critical walkways. When we have these big snow events, the poor WEMS personnel, they're trying like mad to make everything clear as the snow is falling constantly, right? What we did is we got, and that's was our issue last year when everybody fell. What we try to do is we say, okay, which are the biggest pathways that most of the people are going to go? Those are those places in red. That's where we're going to focus our energy. We want to make sure those things are clear first and always. And in addition to that, we're going to put buckets of salt out there, and we tell people that, you know, these guys are trying their best, but if need be, you need to spread that salt out there too. Okay. We ask people to do a personal safety plan that kind of internalizes the fact of what they're going to pledge to do for the next year, so everyone's doing that. And then we have all these safety procedures, but, you know, quite honestly, not everyone's going to read those things, so we put together a Cliff Notes version of our safety requirements that are out there. And then finally, we have all sorts of other activities. I'm not going to go into all these things. I do like this one right here. We're trying to say to people, even though let's say I'm an admin person walking from the car to my place, we really would like you to wear high visibility vests out there, because the lighting is not always good that's out there. People can see each other a lot easier, and wear winter gloves. We are buying gloves for people, and that encourages them, so that instead of having everybody with their hands in their pockets walking, we keep our hands out. We use a handrail as we go up the stairs. Okay. That's really what is the most important things that are out there to help with those injuries. Last and not least, I kind of want to give you guys a little message. Hopefully it will change the way you do things, okay? The stoplight that's out here, right out here, that we all are going to go out through here shortly. We had an individual coming back from lunch go through that stoplight. He had the green light, but the truck that was going across on 32, he did not stop. Killed him. Very, very tragic. Okay. We don't ever want that to happen again. So we have encouraged our people, we've obviously communicated this frequently and loudly. This intersection right here, the traffic may not stop. We put up numerous signs to remind people about that. We've actually worked with the Department of Highway Transportation. They've actually put flashing lights on 32 that tells you that there's street lights that are out there. They've actually widened the backing for their traffic lights so that you can see the red lights easier, because it's usually coming out from that distance where they just don't see it and they're focused on something else. But for all of you, I encourage you, as we all leave tonight, before you cross 32 and you see that, and even though you have that green light, look both ways, make sure that traffic is going to stop. Okay? And hopefully that affects you guys in that way. So, last, I do have some lovely parting gifts. If you guys have any questions, you're more than welcome to ask away, and then I will give you one of these.
Carl. I'm a worker trainer, and the workers that I've been training lately are expressing a lot of frustration in number 5 on your ISMS chart.
Number five, on ISMS. Talking about the first one, Carl?
Yeah, on the first one. Feedback.
Right.
So some of them are saying that they actually have a post-job meeting where they get to express the feedback. Some of them say that after the job, the supervisor says, "Boy, I'm going to have to skim through that one." We had luck to win their back on that one. Then others say they go through all the formal paperwork and submit everything. And there's no accountability. There's no one specific individual that they can go to get an answer. And everybody in the class is various levels, skills, workers, supervisors, managers. And the frustration is at all the levels, that they want to make things better, and there's nobody home.
Okay.
So
So if we have a problem, what do we tell the people to do?
With the problem reports.
Problem reports. These are things that anybody can put in. They can do it anonymously, right?
Now, that's issue number two. They're not getting answers to the problem reports.
But there is this system that's out there we call the problem report system. Anybody can identify their issues that are out there. They are tracked. And they do have to provide an answer. People may not be happy with that answer.
Yeah, that's where the frustration.
Right? That's part of it. But there is that mechanism. What if they don't like that mechanism? What else can they do?
There's a regulator.
There's a regulator. We can go to DOE.
We shouldn't have to go.
Thank you.
To a regulator.
That's right. And we also have a employee advocate who people can also go to. Mostly it's more personnel type issues, but things of that nature. It's not a perfect system, Carl, right?
Well, that's the frustration I've been hearing.
Right. So,
like I said, they all want to make it better, they all want to make it safer, but there's nobody home.
Right. This problem report system, I will say, when I first started, probably about 1,000 a month or something. Now there's probably more like 7,000 or so. I don't know. It's quite high. Some people would say that's bad, right? Because maybe that means that we're just having an increase in problems. I see it as good. It's very similar to if you've been to a Japanese industry. They want people to keep putting in recommendations. Because really, who has a lot of times the best answers for the problem?
The ones doing the work.
The workers. So it is a challenge. Because there's a lot of input that's out there, it's a matter of prioritization trying to take care of it. Okay.
Hey, Barry, you might want to mention for the folks how you chose to organize that book and built around the Safety Six.
Yeah.
Thank
you, Mark. We do focus on those particular areas, like Mark said, the Safety Six. Those are the main areas where we're trying to focus our people's attention. Again, obviously, it's a very hazardous place. So you'll see at the beginning, it's all color-coded, and it runs through the gamut of our different hazards, radiological, you know, electrical, things of that nature. And then it's also color-coded within the book itself so that you can see what's out there. So it's good information. We go in above and beyond what most sites are going to do. So probably if you're working at a place, you don't have a thing called a heat stress program where they're going to try to maintain the person's body temperatures because they're going to wear the whole body suits and things of that nature. Most of you probably don't have a lightning warning system because we got a lot of outdoor work that's going on. We want to make sure that people get that warning before someone's hit. It's a good process. Thank you, Mark. Anybody else?
Any other questions for us? Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
Appreciate it.
Hey, just so you know, after the meeting, the mic's open, you can say.
Open mic.
You can stay all night. We're going home, but you can stay. Thank you, sir, I appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
A lot of good stuff there. All right, next item on the agenda is an administrative issue. It is a draft chair's recommendation from the Idaho Falls National Chairs Meeting. Will, do you want to kick this off?
This is the one recommendation that came out of the National Chairs Meeting in Idaho. And so what we're going to ask is, that we vote as a board, up or down, as it sets. Not allowed to make any changes to it. And, we'll just go from there. So I won't go ahead and read all of it, but the gist of it is that the WIP facility had a couple of accidents there, and that has caused work to cease. So they're not able to take any waste currently into the below storage area, below ground storage area. So the recommendation, as written, is due to the serious problems that the shutdown of the WIP has caused to various DOE facilities that must ship true waste, which is transuranic waste. The Environmental Management Site-Specific Advisory Board recommends that DOE EM headquarters should immediately prepare to expand the above-ground true waste interim storage installation at WIP so that EM sites can proceed with true waste shipments even before the underground WIP disposal operation is approved for real. And that's the recommendation.
I would, we discussed this a little bit, and I knew from the chair meeting too, that I think we should support this recommendation, even though maybe later they'll change the wording a little bit, but for now I think that we need to support this, what they want to do about storing on the ground, and so that there will be an opportunity to send those things.
Okay, so motion in the second.
Is there any discussion or questions on this? Does everybody understand what is going on with this one? This is there's already above ground storage, interim storage with the shutdown of the facility, safety issues. Spring, a couple other sites were unable to complete some shipping campaigns they had, but it would affect some milestones and some big issues. The chairs collectively suggested that it might be beneficial just to expand the interim storage. So in particular Idaho and a little bit of Savannah River and Oak Ridge were the other two sites that were something that had to go ahead and continue their shipping campaign, have that success, get that milestone, and you would have stuff in the queue ready to go into the WIP facility underground as soon as it was back online. So that's kind of what we're supporting. It doesn't really affect us one way or the other. We're just trying to be, as Will said earlier, good neighbors and supportive, most important folks. So. Any questions or discussion from the board? We're going to handle this like we do all recommendations. We're going to open it up to public comment. Anybody from the public would like to provide anything, and then we'll take a vote on this. But before we do that, is there any questions or discussion from the board? Seeing none, are there any public comments on this particular recommendation? All right, I see none. I'm going to need you to raise your right hands, please. All those in favor of supporting this recommendation and allowing Will to put a signature on it with the other chairs, please raise your right hand. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's everyone, thank you. And so we should have no opposition? Abstentions? Perfect, thank you. And we'll sign that, and we'll send that to headquarters and continue to move forward in that direction. All right, subcommittee updates. We did have a couple subcommittees that met since we have been together last. Under tab 6, we have the D&D Remediation Subcommittee. Martha, your group met way back in November. Anything you need to update us on?
Yes, sir. We met on November the 12th, and that meeting was mainly to discuss the public meeting that was going to be held on November 17th. And we wanted to talk about some of the recommendations during the comment period at that public meeting. And so we discussed which ones we wanted to do and who was going to do it. And the action item that we came up with at the end was Floor would email us a draft agenda of the public meeting so that we know where we're coming along. It was a well discussed meeting. Good points came out.
And the SSAB did a very good job representing themselves at the public meeting. We appreciate the good turnout for this group and providing your comments and notes. Any questions or comments for that subcommittee? Thank you, Martha. All right, the future use subcommittee is under tab 7. Mr. Huber's not here. Carlton, would you mind updating this, sir?
Well, we were basically dealing with some of the land transfer updates for SODI, and we're hoping that we can complete some of those land transfers here in the very near future. We understand that part of this whole process of cleaning up this ground could be very quite lengthy, and it's not going to benefit us as the community to not try and get as much of that ground out of this process as we can that has already been cleaned up, so that we might continue to try and possibly put it out there for future use, for industrialization or whatever the community so deems fit. So that was pretty much a lot of our conversation. Of course, we also were there in representation of the meeting that was held there in Waverly, and we discussed who was going to make the comments and that part of our participation in the whole process. That's it.
That group will also be receiving a series of educational sessions on property transfer over the next 3 months. What work plan calls for. It's a lengthy and complicated process to transfer federal land, so we'll make sure you guys are up to speed on how that works. Any questions or comments for Carlton? Thank you, sir. Well done. All right. All right. The Historical Legacy and Community Engagement Committee is under tab 8. And then, of course, is Sherry Manson's group.
We met also on November the 12th. It was very short and brief. We discussed the Science Alliance recap that Jeff had figured and had set in place, and about how well that went, and about this, the potential students and schools that were involved. And it's becoming a very popular thing with schools and schools administrators, and too. I think they're realizing how important it is to our students. And then we also discussed the upcoming Science Bowl, and that will be in March. That's always exciting. You know, you like ball games and football games, but you watch these kids compete in this, and it's just as exciting as those are. And it just shows you how much our kids know. Really makes us proud of all our school kids. So other things, as you saw in some of the pictures that Joel showed about the different fundraising and money that was given to the community for different events,
Any questions for Sharon? That was the last of the subcommittee updates I was aware of. Are there any other updates we need to cover real quick? Outstanding, outstanding. We're going to slide forward to public comment. I have four individuals that have requested time. We have 15 minutes allotted, so Mr. Chase, okay, if we just do 4 minutes a person and slide that way. The first person to request time is Mr. Lee Blackburn. So, if you want to Mike, do you introduce yourself, sir? You have 4 minutes.
Yes, good evening. My name is Lee Blackburn. I want to thank the board for allowing me to take a few minutes to speak. Unlike Barry, I won't do karaoke. I do, however, want to talk about an issue related to safety. It's not safety pertaining to the individuals, the associates that work on site, but rather safety of the entire community. The site-specific advisory board has been urging DOE for some years now to dig up the on-site landfills and consolidate them with any proposed on-site disposal sale to further economic development on the site. DOE has reluctantly agreed to do this, but only for landfills within Perimeter Road. However, landfills within the Perimeter Road represent just 45% of total landfill acreage and totally ignore the highly contaminated X-734 sites. X-734, along with X-734A and X-734B, cover approximately 17 plus acres just to the north of Plant Perimeter Road. They are believed not to be lined and contain, among other hazards, organic solvents, including known carcinogens, TCE, toluene, ketone, sodium hydroxide, ammonium hydroxide, and PCBs. In addition, there are heavy metals, both mercury and cadmium, empty drums formerly containing hazardous metals, and uranium-contaminated soils from the X-342 area. DOE's proposed plan for this site-wide waste disposition evaluation project is supposed to be protective of health, human health, safety, and the environment. But by leaving the unlined and toxic X-734 landfills untouched, the plan not only risks human health, it will likely limit future economic development of the site. I would therefore urge each member of the board to send an email on this issue to wdcomments@fbports.com. Voicing your opinion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Blackburn. Appreciate that. The next person listed is Ms. Pat Maria.
Hi, my name is Pat Maria. I'm the chair of the Ohio Sierra Club's Nuclear Free Committee. And I just really like to second what Lee has said. We have submitted written comments some time ago and supporting alternative two, which would be having all current on-site landfills, but also both those within and outside the perimeter road. And all those be fully excavated and consolidated with the wastes within waste to be disposed of within the OSDC and or shipped off-site per the WAC WAC for purposes of being protective of human health, safety, and the environment. So we do think it would be unnecessarily expensive to ship it somewhere else, someplace that no one else wants it either. And so what is as safe as possible to be stored here should be stored here, and what needs to be stored more safely would be shipped off-site. The Ohio Sierra Club opposes nuclear power and weapons in all their forms because they're expensive and dangerous. And as we can see, you know, there's a lot of expenses coming up now for cleanup. So expense, it seems like if the ratepayers, the taxpayers are going to pay it, that's seems to be no limit to the cost overruns and so forth. And if it's for something that's, you know, real sexy new technology, that's great. But when it comes to getting funding for cleanup and safety and so forth, then it's much more difficult to get. And so we would surely encourage the DOE to put some money into this. There's also many more jobs. There's a huge number of jobs involved with cleanup. And that's not as sexy either. And so we don't see you know, these companies that are wanting the new XYZ kind of nuke. They don't want to know about the waste that they created with their last thing. And so, you know, we oppose new facilities and projects until the old things are cleaned up. So we say that the solution to waste is not to create any more of it. So thank you.
Thank you. And I apologize for mispronouncing your name. I'm so sorry.
No problem.
Jeffrey C. Sorry, snuck out. Does he come back in? All right, let's slide past. And Dr. Manute here.
Thank you and Happy New Year to everyone. David Manuta, former chief scientist at the site, and now president of Manuta Chemical Consulting. I've got three quick points. Will raised an excellent question before about the X623 and the 0 pounds of TCE identified. One of the first things that, and especially I think there's at least six newcomers who are coming up to speed on what went on. The trichloroethylene was used as a degreaser for cleaning equipment and small parts and such over the years. It's got the unique capacity of basically cleaning and dissolving everything. Problem is that unlike most organic solvents, it's much denser than water is. And so there's an issue with the way it migrates. And so if you follow gravity, it's going to go deep. And so one of the issues that I think ultimately Will's question addresses is how deep do you go into the soil before you reach the point of no return? And my suspicion is that there should be some form of mapping so that you have some idea in advance about what you're likely to find and how deep you need to go. And again, I'm not privy to that information, but I'd like to believe that it exists. Okay, a couple of really quick points, putting my physics hat on now. In Barry's presentation, he was talking about speeding on site. One of the things that we do as investigators is to determine when someone is going at a certain rate, in this case miles per hour, you want to do the conversion to feet per second. And this addresses one of Carl's issues, I think, that this actually ought to be part of training. So when workers come in and you're told the speed limit is 20 miles per hour in a certain area, because fundamentally, each 10 miles per hour is the equivalent of about 15 feet per second. And so whether you're dealing with something in a parking lot where people are driving 5 miles an hour, it's one of the more interesting things when I tell people, you're actually going 7 feet per second. And that's why you ran over that child or you hit some other object that you didn't expect to see there. And the same thing goes on the other end with NASA when you've got a spaceship that's traveling thousands of miles an hour. And you realize that in each second, it's actually going several miles. So that sort of stuff, I think, should be part of a training protocol. Last part was brought up on the safety, and especially with the weather like it is now. One of the peculiarities when you salt the roads is, depending on the kind of salt you're using, oftentimes when it's, say, below about 10 degrees Fahrenheit, there isn't anything that works other than a blade on the surface. And so I think we want people to be aware that as good as science is, we can't answer all of this, but at least we have the ability to point us in the right direction.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate your time. Any final comments from the board?
We are safe to home.
Yep. Be careful. We're adjourned.